And joining us live in the studios is another security expert, Ambassador Roy Okhidievbe. Thank you very much for joining us, Ambassador.
Thank you. It's always a privilege. Yeah.
Let's take a reaction to all of this development. What's your take on this?
Well, community policing, in the essence of it, is that you must have a community.
Okay?
Because in the present scenario that we have, what we have is anarchy. Okay, we don't have a community. Community is based on people living together with ethics, norms, in tradition, religion, cultures. You know, we need to generate that. Then another thing about policing is the appropriate content of the actors.
Okay.
You know, and when you talk about policing and you are saying that the traditional rulers should be the ones to begin to look at recruiting people, and I have a disagreement with that, because when you look at the content of security practitioners that you have in a state that they belong to by birth, they should be called together. They should be the ones to actually work with a system to begin to vet the people that will be actors in such community policing. And you know, so many universities now have advanced diploma, diploma in security studies, cybercrime security studies. A lot of youths have been churned out of these universities. Some of them are in banks working as tellers. Some of them are in so many other disciplines. So we could put those people to a great advantage. So if you want to achieve community policing, like Kabiru said, you must balance the disadvantages, proliferation of arms. You must make sure the community itself addresses the irregularities in norms, you know, and the judicial system should engage in speedy trials and fair trials.
Yeah. Now, what would you say is the difference between community policing and state policing, and why the issue of state policing is still being kept behind? Why are we not embracing the concept of state policing?
Well, I've said it a lot of times.
Yes.
It's one of the issues I have with this Amotekun stuff now. Because if you want to approve state police for a state, the state must have seen to have grown through the generative content. We used to have constabulary, we used to have these police officers in Nigeria that would wear short knickers. You know, they generated into what we have today. It was formerly police force. Later they said police, so that it comes closer to the people, not a force. Okay, so if you want to have state police, you should have other arms of policing that you have grown to the extent that you can fund them and have a partnership with private organizations to make sure they are motivated and all the other technological inputs. So if you have this state policing and you can't pay your staff, you can't pay teachers for months running as a governor, then if you can't pay police that is in your state that are carrying arms for 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 months, then you should know that you have a bandwagon of bandits.
Now, amazingly, I came across a statistics put together by the Western Nigerian Security Network, Amotekun. Currently, as obtainable in the country, we have about 400,000 policemen. And just in the Southwest alone, we have 58,000 police officers in the Southwest to guard about 50 million people. Let's talk about the police reformation at this point in time. Is it critical at this point for us to reform the Nigerian police as it is?
We have reformed and reformed and reformed. The reformation plan of the Nigerian police that we have now, what it needs is action. Procrastination has been the bane of so much distraction in Nigeria.
Yeah.
You know, once we put action into the reformation plan, one of the reformation plan is the training institutes, the training content, then input of technology, motivation. That will attract the right persons. Like you, you'll just be surprised that you go and get a form that you want to join the police. Why? It will become attractive. It will be directed to solving problems and the right content of persons who want to join it. So any reformation that we have done, can we start to execute? Can we have a training school that we have people like me, like you, coming to talk to them about media? Coming, people like me having opportunities to come in to talk to them? And can we have them motivated? Can we have the training school having technology as one of the core contents of input? Then when you have that, then people will volunteer themselves. to be a member. So all the reforms that we need to do, we have enough. They should stop all the committees and start action plans on what we have on ground already.
Okay. Now, the United Nations recommendation is one police officer to about 450 people, almost 450 people. But as it currently obtains in Nigeria, it's like we have one police officer to about 862 people.
Yeah, there's misplaced priority in our security architecture.
And half of the total numbers of 400,000 policemen, I mean, half of that number actually attaches to VIPs
that's
in the country.
That's what I want to say, you know? Yeah. So we have misplaced priority because number one is that we have not recruited the right quantity of police officers because...
And what would be the right quantity, sorry? What would be the right
quantity?
That is
the statistics that you are trying to raise.
Okay.
So when we have the quantity of police officers to meet the required insecurity prevalence, then you now look at priority. How do you deploy them? Where are they deployed? You know, so if they are deployed to serve the masses, to serve the people, not the government personnel, not the government, the governors, then you can now see that you can rate their performance and the effectiveness of the deployment, because they will be immediately combating this challenge. Not that, okay, if you have an election now in Edo State, you will just hear that 50,000 police officers are deployed to Edo State. And you will be asking where they came from.
Yeah.
So I think that we should look at priority on where we deploy our police officers before we can actually know the effectiveness of what we have right now.
On ground.
Yeah.
Okay. This has been some arguments in some quarters about the seclusion of the Nigerian police in barracks, that in other developed countries, Western countries, the police live amongst the people. And do you think this is also part of the problem we might be having? Because the police live in barracks. They're supposed to be amongst the people. And do you see this community policing solving this issue of seclusion of police people living in the barracks all by themselves?
Well, I think I'm a retired military personnel.
Yeah.
And I would advise that who has that statistic should go and do their findings. You know, so many police officers live in the communities. So many. There are so many people that wear their civil dress, leave your house, come back with their civil dress. If you find out properly, some of them are police officers. Because the barrack we speak about, go to Ikoyi, just stand on that Falomo Bridge, you know, and look at that barrack that you have there. It's an eyesore. You know, most of the barracks that we have, you can't bring up your children there. You can't bring up family there. If you have relevance for the kind of children you bring up today, you can't live there. You know, so many of them live in the communities. And another thing you need to understand with the barrack system is that they need a place where they can call them to action.
Yeah.
Because of what we have as a community right now, as the society that we have, the police have been taken to a combative level. They are reactive to situations. The military and other agencies, mobile police
Which
officers should react.
The
yes.
Yes.
The police should be proactive. You know, so that is why you see this combative nature. And if we can give them opportunities to be proactive by intelligence, by electronic opportunities and all that, you will see that their combative nature we wane down.
Ambassador Roy Okhidievbe, thank you very much for joining us on News on the Hour and for your in-depth contribution.
It's a pleasure.